Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Daytona International Speedway. Hopefully you can hear me this time, because last time we were at Daytona, you guys couldn't hear me. So I'm pretty sure you guys can hear me now. This is the halfway point in our 36 race season for the Budweiser All-Pro Series. And I'm not alone. Stepping in for Kyle Matthews today will be Mr. Seth Cole. Seth, thank you for joining me up here in the booth.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Daytona International Speedway, under the lights, July 4th weekend. Man, this is definitely a great place to be.
Well, it definitely is, and it's going to play such a pivotal point in this particular area of the season as well, because coming into this race, we've got 15 different drivers that have been to victory lane, which really leaves only one spot currently up for grabs for a driver to make their way into the playoffs via points. And whenever we come to a track like Daytona or Talladega, we always consider it a wild card race, because it's usually not who has the best car, it's who positions themselves in the right place at the right time when we get down to the end of the race. So I think that this is where a lot of drivers that don't yet have a one or a two in the win column, they're looking here tonight as an opportunity to be able to get themselves into playoff competition. So I think you're going to see a lot of aggressive racing, and I think you're going to see some mistakes being made, which will potentially lead to us having a big one.
Yeah, well, let's hope that that doesn't happen. All these drivers are definitely vying to get in. And we also have two people currently who are locked in to the chase with their two wins, one of them being our points leader in the number 22, that's Jack Halleck, who's starting deep in the field today. Probably the worst qualifying he's had all season long, because he's usually qualifies in the top 10. We see him back here about mid-pack here. Jack Halleck in that number 22 car, and then the second one that's locked into the chase, somebody who needed a second win for how far back in the point she is, Jessica Shelton, starting in the fifth position today, or excuse me, tonight.
We definitely know that Jessica Shelton's very good at these super speedways as well. And look at you got the teammates there lined up on the insides of rows 1, 2, and 3. Matthews on the pole, Sanford starting in third, Shelton starting in fifth. That's a huge advantage for those Camaros when we drop the green flag.
Yeah, and it's very surprising. Lately, it's been the Fords. The Fords have been all dominant. In qualifying and even racing as of late. But now you got a Chevy and a Toyota on the front row here, and very much an unpredictable race. I can't wait for this to get started.
Definitely going to be unpredictable. It won't be until we get down to maybe about 5 laps to go that we'll start to see the drivers that we can pick out that we think will be contenders for the win. Right now, I think, especially in the first half of the race, it's going to be all about survival and making sure you're in the right place at the right time to avoid the big one when and if it happens.
And we're not even going to attempt to make picks because of our history.
Exactly. We don't want to jinx anybody.
Yep, so here we go.
It's not good.
Pace car in, green flag is out. We're underway in the Coke Zero Sugar 400. Everybody made it to the green flag.
How anxious these drivers are to try going 3 wide. Usually that's not a terrible thing at Daytona. It can usually hold them 3 wide, but when they start going 4 wide, that's when you start to get a little bit anxious.
Yep. Kyle Matthews with the lead, going to go to the high line with his teammate Charles Sanford, but here comes the 0-2 down the inside. Shelton being pushed by Dougie Shears.
Very interesting that both Matthews and Sanford dove up to the outside line there. Some Daytonas, you can actually get a good runoff turn two and get good straightaway speed, but we can see right there, inside line there through 3 and 4, definitely preferred.
Yep, coming to the line. I believe Jessica just barely led that lap. And you're right, here they are already three wide in the mid-pack here.
Notice down there on the inside line, that red, white, and blue Chevrolet of Trent Dunham. We already know the love-hate relationship he has for Daytona, but that's for the Daytona 500. Usually, in most schedules, when we come to the second Daytona race of the season, that team and that driver tend to do a little bit better. So, him up here fighting for the lead early.
Yep. Trent Dunham already down the inside to the lead, being pushed by Levi McIntyre in the number 99 car.
Remember you mentioned about Jack Halleck, the points leader, starting in the mid-pack. Well, he's already worked his way up into the top 10.
Yeah, he has. Actually, he crosses the line in the sixth position. Man, these cars are really all three wide now. This is a hornet's
three
nest.
Three wide, about 10 rows deep.
This is a hornet's nest as rookie William Flickinger takes the lead now. Here comes the 22 of Jack Halleck, but he's going to open the door to the inside to the 26 of Daniel Voiles.
Okay, I'm sorry. I have to stop you there. The 96 is sponsored by Star Wars. Did you just call him the Wookiee, Zach Flickinger? Because it really sounded like you said that.
I said the rookie, but I mean,
hey, it sounded like Wookiee on my end, and just the irony really made me chuckle.
William Flickinger is able to lead this lap. Here comes in a couple of other cars here. You got Daniel Gilbert in the 77. Nathan Orman down the inside here. Nathan Hudson coming up down there. Nathan Hudson's had a very dismal season.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the last time that I was in the booth, it was Nathan Hudson looked like he was going to win the All-Star race and had some kind of mechanical failure on the final lap under caution. So, definitely, I know what you're talking about with his struggles.
Yep. Flickinger is the first person so far to be able to actually hold the draft and hold the lead.
He's doing a good job. Doing a good job channeling the inner Dale Earnhardt there, or Dale Earnhardt Jr., whichever you want to as he moves from the inside to the outside line, doing a really good job. And now he's got, I think that's Stoltz behind him, Johnny Gardner, Phil Parker's there as well. I think Gardner and Parker, if I'm not mistaken, are teammates, so they
have
worked together.
The 21-33 are teammates. That's Zachary Stoltz, who's already has a win this season. He booked it down to the inside of Hummer. Excuse me. He booked it on the inside off of the trail over there to get the lead. But now here comes Gardner looking low to the inside. And also inside is that number three of Cole Deaver.
How cool would it be to see the iconic number three go to victory lane here?
Oh, my God. I saw the 60 car get a bit sideways. I thought we were going to have a wreck.
That was more than a bit sideways. He went up, I think, a second groove in that middle line. And I don't know if I think that was William Flickinger. Thank goodness he gave him room to be able to gather that race car back up.
Yeah, he did. Three wide for the lead. Dougie Shear, Sebastian Coquelin, Preston Plourde down the inside. Couple of teammates down there,
behind
too.
Behind them, you got Emmanuel Hartnett. That's another driver that started out the season really struggling. I had a good finish. They've been a little more consistent last few weeks, worked their way up to 19th in the standings. So we'll see if here at Daytona, if maybe they can get themselves in the win column. And I mean, there's so many big names here in this field that are yet to go to victory lane. Keith Batson, Jordan Lopez, Rob Evans, the aforementioned Emmanuel Hartnett, Robert up at the front. Like I said, just so many drivers wanting to use a track like Daytona, where you're able to, in some ways, maneuver your way to the front, trying to use this as a springboard to be able to get themselves into playoff competition.
Yeah, and here comes Emmanuel Hartnett, now going to take the lead, being pushed by JT Bryant, and then he got Emmanuel Hartnett's teammate, Seth Cole, down on the inside as well.
What's also going to be interesting, too, let's just speculate that we do have a different driver go to victory lane here. Heading into the next few weeks is going to be absolutely crazy because we'll have 16 different race winners, and it's really then going to come down to in the next few weeks about who's got to win and who's highest in the point standings.
Yep, which is why Jessica Shelton is glad she got herself a second win, locking herself in.
Absolutely. Absolutely. They're almost four wide, but it's at the back of the field I saw. Looked like they attempted it for a brief moment, and that's not exactly a smart thing to do.
Yeah. God, this is a hornet's nest if I've ever seen one.
There's Chris Dollerton. There's Rob Evans. We talked about him. Shane Lake is up to the front, comes the 36. I think that's Jose Mills, if my memory serves me correctly.
Yep, Jose Mills, 36 car. Here comes Rob Evans. Oops. Rob Evans down the inside, being pushed by Shane Lake, Keith Batson, Kev Shearer. That's another driver who's been struggling this year.
Yeah, and we talked before we came on the air about Keith Batson, seventh in the point standings, highest in the points without a victory. So obviously He's been very consistent, but he just hasn't been able to get that Blue Angels Ford Mustang in victory lane. He might be able to do it here as he's getting a good shove from the Starcom Chevy of Kev Shear.
Yep, down the inside lane. Here come, you know, we're gonna do something breathtaking. We are going to go on board with somebody who's in the middle of this pack. Let's take a look and see what it looks like. Boy, that is just breathtaking, isn't it?
And the thing that makes me so nervous is that the cars in that middle line, you can see they're not really able to hold it steady. They're moving back and forth. It's so aerodynamically difficult to keep your car in a straight line when you've got someone to your inside and someone to your outside. So, difficult area to be in when you're stuck in that middle line, which they dub at the super speedways, the sucker hole. Look how that 60 car is back and forth.
Yep.
Now it's really looking like all three lanes are having the same number of cars. Obviously, the shortest way around the racetrack is the inside line.
I agree.
The drivers that are down there are making up positions, but with cars on the inside, middle, and outside line, and look who's gotten up to the front there, Jay Jefferson.
Yep, Jay Jefferson in the 11 car already has a win this season. He's leading the pack here. You got Cody Llamas up here. And there's also one other driver that I noticed who kind of sneaking his way into the top 10. And that's our Daytona 500 winner, Benjamin Miles.
I'd love to be able to go for the Daytona sweep. Took about 10 laps, and we finally have our pole sitter, Kyle Matthews, back up here towards the front there around the third, fourth position.
Jessica Shelton back up here too.
I saw Charles Sanford make an appearance back up at the front not moments ago, but now he's been trapped up on that outside line.
Here comes Cody Llamas.
Yeah, how would he love to win here? Cody Llamas, a Florida native, would love to win in front of his home crowd.
Yeah, and now look at Jessica Shelton. Hardly any help. Going to go three wide for the lead, and now she has help at Benjamin Miles.
She didn't have help, but she had a run, and so much momentum is used here at Daytona. You can't lift. If you lift, you're going to lose positions because you're going to find yourself about 5 to 10 miles per hour slower than everybody else who still has their throttle mashed down to the floor. So
I thought
in these situations, if you see an opening, you got to take it whether anyone goes with you or not.
I thought I saw four wide in the back here.
They've been attempting four wide a couple of times at the very rear of the field. I mean, I think that they're kind of in desperation mode back there, jostling to see who can get that inside line to be able to work their way back to the front.
Yep. Here comes our Daytona 500 winner, Benjamin Miles. He's going to take the lead off into turns three and four here.
Jordan Lopez, that 17, another driver that's up in the top 10 in points, but doesn't have a victory now up towards the front here. Jack Halleck, points leader, back to the front again. Here come the Fords. You got them lined up there, the 17, the 22, and the 99 of Levi McIntyre.
Yep, here comes 17 now down the inside lane. He's going to be trying to clear him if he can get clear. Did he get clear? I don't know. Probably not. Yep, he did.
Quite
he,
clear.
He got
quite
it.
Yet.
He got it. He got his clear now. The 17 leads this lap. Man, we've been caution-free since the start of this race.
There's been a couple of hairy moments. Oh, no. Oh, that 96 of William Flickinger getting put in the middle.
Whoa, okay.
He's able to tuck in behind McIntyre. Oh, James Qualls let him in. Thank heavens.
I saw the 26 columns get turned.
Man.
Yep. These cars just need to calm down a little bit.
James Qualls, because if he hadn't let William Flickinger in, we probably would have had the big one, and that would have been right up at the front of the field where it would have started.
Oh, we got a wreck! We got a wreck! We got a wreck in the back! There
oh,
it is.
Boy. There we go. Yep. And I think he got hooked off the nose of Phil Parker. Did he save it?
No, he didn't. Not quite. A couple of other cars got involved, but no one else really spun out. In all honesty.
Yeah, Kukulon got a little bit of damage. Someone got sent down to pit road, I think.
Oh, no, look at that 09. He's got front-end damage, and so does the 79 got front-end damage as well. I think they ran it. They had to have ran into somebody while they were trying to check up.
did. I think you're absolutely right. Speaking tough of, break there for the Pulsar.
Speaking of people checking out, we got more wrecking under caution here.
Oh, boy. Wow.
Some people just don't know how to use the brakes.
Kukulon, Rob Evans, J.J. Roberts. I see a lot of rear-end damage on Alex Benyako.
Yeah.
Damage, I thought, as well on the back of the 60 of Nathan Hudson.
So about halfway through the race, he's got damage on the front end, too. So about halfway through the race, and we've got wrecking under caution and an actual caution flag. That's going to take out some cars. It's going to make them slow, which means they're going to
absolutely.
Which means now they're going to play a factor into this.
Well, possibly. I think, I don't know. We may have run enough laps under green where when we end up getting the green flag again, we may not catch that traffic before we get to the checkers. It's going to be close.
Well, let's hope not. But let's go back, take a look, and see what happened to Chris Dollerton to bring out the first caution of the night here at Daytona. All right, we're taking a look and see what happened here. Chris Dollerton gets a little too antsy and tries to go 4-1 and just comes right down into Phil Parker.
I'm not sure he tried going 4-wide. I think he thought he was clear on Parker, actually, because it looked like Kev Shearer got a little loose. Dollerton didn't want to kill his momentum, so he thought about diving down to the inside line, and unfortunately the 33 was there, but there you see where
he had it saved.
Navarro and Kyle Matthews.
Yeah, he had it saved, and then the 12 car just came up and bounced him up into other cars.
And then he bounces off of Cole Deaver down into the 84. We saw how Kyle Matthews and Angel Navarro got their damage when Dollerton went up. I think he went into Jay Jefferson, and that just stacked the whole outside lineup.
All right, now I'm going to put it back into here as we're going to watch the rest of these cars just start stacking up here.
I think the stack up we were talking about started from Nathan Hudson on back.
Going 140 miles an hour, slowing down.
And watch the 81 of J.J. Roberts. There's a big gap between himself and Hudson.
Yep, no one just wanted to slow down.
Nope. You saw Sanford and Shane Lee and Preston Plourdal jump up to the outside.
Yeah, look at the 23. Emmanuel Hardnett saw that and jumped up to the outside as well.
Chris Dollerton, for the most part, I think that car only got mostly side damage, maybe a little bit of damage on the rear, so he might be okay.
We're going to have to wait and see what happens, but we're going to go back for the restart and see who's going to pull it off here at Daytona. And we are back here at Daytona for the Coke Zero Sugar 400. Four cars have retired out of the race. They include Angel Navarro, J.J. Roberts, Michael Turner, and Sebastian Kukulon. After that incident,
I'm really surprised that we only have four cars out.
Yeah, probably mostly from all the stacking up that they did there. But your quick top...
I don't think any of them were actually involved in the initial wreck, or at least not...
Well, the 79 was. 79 was. We saw the front end on the front end of his car, yeah. Quick top 10 rundown, Jordan Lopez leading, oddly enough, in a 17 car out of plate track. Trent Dunham, Daniel Gilbert, Nathan Orman, William Flickinger, Zach Rogers, Levi McIntyre, Benjamin Miles, Johnny Gardner, and Daniel Voiles. Pace car ducks off, and we're getting ready to go back under the green flag with, what, about 12 laps to go, I think?
12 laps to go.
Hold on, let's see. 19, 20. No, it's 14 laps to go.
Yeah, we're taking the green on lap 20, so yeah, it actually would be...
Lap 19.
13 to go.
No, it's lap 19. We took the green flag.
Oh, it's pixelated. Don't blame me.
We're on lap 19 of 32. We have about 14 laps to go, and the front two pulled out to a good lead.
Yeah, they did. That's not exactly what they want to do here, though, because if third place on back start to get lined up, they're going to have a lot of momentum, and you're going to find... Both Lopez and Dunham is sitting ducks. I think Trent Dunham realizes that. He wants to get to the inside line and pick up that momentum that's coming in the form of Nathan Orman, Daniel Gilbert, and Zach Rogers.
Yep, and he did. Trent Dunham's going to lead the lap, but here comes Orman down to the inside with the help.
going back to your point earlier, when we had that wreck, I mean, we're restarting with more than 10 laps to go. We should probably take a little peek towards the rear of the field about some of those damaged cars, see if they are off the pace and just how much off the pace they are to see if could be a factor in the closing stages. Ooh, I'd be worried about that 60.
Yeah, no hood. He's got a... He's... Yeah, I definitely believe that.
Somehow he's kind of keeping the same speed as Dalton in the 83, Dougie Shears in the 84, so I'd be a little worried about them as well, because they're going to have no draft. That's going to make their speeds even slower, as you've got a big pack up here that are going to produce a lot of speed. So yeah, to your point, traffic could very well come into play before we reach the checkers.
New leader, Johnny Gardner in the 21. Evans Gardner Motorsports up here leading. You got Jack Halleck in second. Here comes James Qualls and Kev Scheer up here.
We talked about Jessica Shelton getting that victory last week, putting her at number two in the win column. I mean, deviated off of her, but how about Jack Halleck as well? Two wins, points leader. This guy could go out there and make some really aggressive moves to try and get his third win. I mean, if he wrecks out, penalize him that much in terms of making it into the playoffs.
I agree. Front two kind of broken away a little bit. Shelton,
yeah, three wide for third.
You see Shelton, oddly enough, right there behind Kev Scheer. She could be the one that can she could be the one that can try to push up there.
Absolutely, you're right. Both the 22 and the 02 right now, I think their goal is to just go for more wins, because they both know that they're going to be making it into the playoffs regardless. So I think they have pressure of all these drivers, especially at a track like Daytona, where, you know, it comes down to strategic drivers. They don't, you know, Halleck and Shelton, they don't have to really rely on strategy right now. They can be as aggressive as they want.
That's very true. We got 10 laps to go, and Kev Scheer just gets turned up into the wall. We have another accident. Kev Scheer. Oh, Kev Scheer. Oh, no, that's Benjamin
and
Miles
this is
flipping.
This is a really big one.
This
oh,
is
boy.
The big one. Oh, my gosh. There's still wrecking cars.
Tell 500 winners upside down.
There's still wrecking cars flipping up, flying in the cars.
Oh, my goodness. Parker brakes are real here tonight. Oh, my goodness. Flipping upside down. Zorlin was flipping.
Oh, man. Cole Deaver, Jessica Shelton. We were just talking about her. Benjamin Miles, Charles Sanfer, James Qualls, the 39 car. He's up in smoke. The 44.
Yeah, Alex Tanker's got damage. Andrew Davis going through the grass. I don't know if he got damage or not.
Kyle Matthews, Daniel Gilbert.
It's easier to name off the people that weren't involved rather than those that were.
S3 Motorsports, you have the 88 car on pit road. There's the 29 of Alex Bianco. Man, Daniel Voyles.
There were at least five or six cars that were upside down in that wreck. And it took place in one of the worst places for a wreck to happen at Daytona, heading into the banking of turn one. It's so difficult to avoid a wreck there.
Well, at least we know we won't have to worry about lap cars now.
Yeah,
with how many
yeah,
laps
very
left.
True.
Dylan Young, man, he's just had a really tough season.
Another Florida native was looking for a good run.
Well, Jack Halleck has the lead here and a very now diminished field. As we're going to go take a look and see at the big one, go through it, and then come back for the restart. All right, we're looking here at Kev Scheer. Kev just goes up the track as, like, I don't even know what he was thinking. Crowds Jessica Shelton, and Shelton just turns him into the wall.
When we were watching it live, I thought maybe Kev was trying to move up, thinking the 48 was to his inside, but Cody was nowhere near the left rear quarter panel, so I'm not really sure what went on with Kev right there.
Ooh, a hard hit to the 44
car. Just look
at
the cars involved. Man!
And there's the 20. There's the 25 car flipping. Look at Preston Plore just kind of slide through there. The 88.
You see where
Yep, 80.
Hits Zorlin upside down. Ethan Miles was looking for the Daytona sweep. That's not going to happen.
There's the 9 of Zach Rogers with his hood all, with his front end all smashed in.
And then if we go further back.
Holy cow, did you see the 29?
Second pack that came flying into the initial wreck. And that's why we had Benyako up in the air. I think that's what, there were a couple of other cars that were flipping as well. I think as a result, I'm trying to remember who they were.
Oh, he got hit by the 14 car. All of S3 Motorsports was involved in this. Oh my God, Kev Scheer! Yeah,
he get clobbered by? Was that...
He got clobbered by somebody.
JT Bryant.
Oh no, he got clobbered by Dylan Young first.
Oh, yep, you're right.
My God. It was carnage in turns 1 and 2 here.
Yeah, we had the wreck, and then I'm pretty certain there were some of those damaged cars that were further back, and they just didn't lift, and they came flying in.
I don't know why they wouldn't lift if they see smoke, but, you know.
Look at Dollerton, Dougie Shears, and Nathan Hudson. They were off the pace at the rear of the field, and they all three made it through, so they're picking up spots there.
Yeah, especially with cars retiring. Well, let's go back up. Yeah, let's go back up, see who's left, and get the finish here at Daytona. Welcome back to Daytona. We've got
back to the Budweiser shootout.
Yep, welcome back to the Budweiser shootout. We got 22 cars in the field. No, but seriously though, we got a long list of cars retired, and we're going to try to go through them as much as we can. We have the 9 of Zach Rogers, James Qualls, Levi McIntyre, Alex Miller, Keith Batson, Charles Sanford, Jessica Shelton, Benjamin Miles, Daniel Voiles, the 88 of Jonathan Zorlein, the 00 Kev Scheer, the 29 of Alex Benyako, the 2 of Dylan Young, the 3 Cole Deaver, and the 12 of JT Bryant, the 14 car of who was that? You have the
14
roster.
Andrew Davis.
That's right. Sorry, it's been forever. That's the last car to retire from the big one. A quick rundown at your top 10 as we're coming to the green. Jack Halleck, Jose Mills, Johnny Gardner, Zachary Stoltz, William Flickinger, Dylan Poteet, Cody Lamas, Shane Lake, Jay Jefferson, and Phil Parker.
You mentioned 22 cars are still running, but in reality, only 13 of them are really in the hunt for this win. From Trent Dunham back behind him, I think it's Jordan Lopez on back. They are damaged from either the last wreck we just saw or the initial caution.
That's true. Green flag is back out. We have 5 laps to go.
Wonder, could they possibly wreck here with only 22 cars in the field?
Shush, don't jinx it. I want this race to end in the green, okay? Couple of 2-car tandems, Johnny Gardner and others. Now they're going to go towards the middle lane here. Dylan Poteet working with Cody Lamas in the middle line. They're really leaving that 22 car out to dry.
Definitely are. I think everybody realizes that he's got 2 wins and they don't want to push him to a third.
That's true. Zachary Stoltz.
Close.
Zachary Stoltz has 1
Cody
win.
Lamas tried to get down in front of Dylan Poteet, and Poteet says, no, Lama.
72 car, Zachary Stoltz, he already has a win. The 96 car doesn't, though, and neither does the 43. 4 laps of racing to go. Here comes Shane Lake on the inside line, as well as the 31 of Dylan Poteet off of the turn.
Here's the ironic thing. I'm not seeing much opportunity for teammates to work together up here.
No, well, unless Phil Parker can get to the back of the 21.
That's what I was wondering about, Phil Parker and Johnny Gardner, but Phil's actually losing some ground there, so he might have gotten a little bit of damage that we didn't know about.
No, they're just struggling to catch. They're just struggling to catch up. Really, look at Trent Dunham trying to catch up as well.
Hey, Jefferson, good job there by the 11. He got damage I know of in that first wreck, as he got contact in the driver's side door from Chris Dollerton when Dollerton spun, but he's still up to speed with a chance of winning this thing.
3 laps of racing to go. Can Johnny Gardner control the draft?
He's looking more in his rearview mirror than he is out the windshield, I guarantee you that.
Trent Dunham finally did catch up to this pack. He's in the back now behind the 72 car, not really an inside line forming.
That outside line's got more cars, though, with Halleck leading the way, and so he's going to clear into second. Looks like Poti might clear for third. Nope, Stoltz going to get to his inside.
Nope, now Dylan might have it. Dylan now might have it cleared for the inside. Yep, there he goes. Two laps of racing to go, and we have the 22 of Jack Halleck going for the lead. Poti says no, and he goes to the outside lane.
Going to work with a Chevrolet instead of with a Ford. And again,
oh, never like mind, said, he changed his mind.
Ganging up on the 22, though. They all want to make sure he doesn't get a third victory.
He changed his mind, though. Then he went to the inside.
It happens here at these tracks. You have a plan, and then all of a sudden, within a corner, you're like, nope, nope, completely new drawing board.
Yep, and now Dylan Poti. Man, this is a... I think this is about a 9-10 car battle here.
Now it is, yeah. Yep, and if I'm these guys up here at the front, Halleck and Poti, I don't think this is where I want to be coming to the white.
The white flag is in the air. One lap of racing to go. Dylan Poti trying to get the inside line to work.
Like where that 72 car is at right now.
I don't know. We'll see. The 22 car on his outside lane. If Poti can't clear the 22, the 22 car... Nope,
Dylan. Poti can keep it down on the bottom. Oh, he moved up. I don't know why he moved up, because here comes Stoltz, and he's got Jose Mills pushing him.
Zachary Stoltz in the 72 car. He's going to get clear of Dylan Poti. Heading off.
What about Jose Mills? Is Mills going to try and make a move here out of four?
I don't think so. He's not trying to. There he goes. He's going to look, but it's going to be the...
have enough momentum. Poti goes with him.
Nope, it's going to be Zachary Stoltz picking up his second win of the season.
Liked where he was when we took the white flag. I thought he was in the best position if Poti couldn't hold the bottom off turn two. Sure enough, right place, right time.
I don't know, man, but that 22, Jack Halleck really fought for it.
Yes, he did, no doubt about that, and now... we've got our third confirmed driver, basically, in the playoffs. Stoltz, who came into this race eighth in the overall point standings, now with a two in the win column. Well, he's going to join Jessica Shelton and Jack Halleck as being locked into the playoffs as far as confirmed contenders.
As the 77 car crosses the start-finish line, the race has become official. We're going to go watch the 72 do his burnout and head to victory lane, and then we'll come back for the results. Zachary Stoltz gonna come here to celebrate his second win of the season at number 72 Chevy Camaro.
What did we say? Top of the program. It was all about being in the right place at the right time, and that's exactly where Zachary Stoltz was. And we talked about Daytona possibly being an area where drivers could springboard themselves up into the championship picture as far as lock. Themselves up into the playoffs, and Stoltz did just that.
Absolutely, he did. Driving through the famous Daytona logo in the grass.
I think he'll be able to find his way to victory lane since he's got a GoPro in there, probably.
Yeah, GoPro. His GoPro number 72 Chevy.
Okay, I was wrong.
Zachary Stoltz now he's in victory lane in that number 72 car. Let's go get the results and wrap it up here at Daytona. With Zachary Stoltz in victory lane celebrating his second win of the season, Jose Mills, Dylan Poti, Shane Lake, and Trent Dunham finished your top five.
Just an unbelievable job by these guys because, to be honest, the only reason they had a shot of winning this race is they were able to survive the carnage that took place in those two wrecks.
Yeah. Right place, right time. Staying up near the front. Although that's where the big wreck started, thanks to Kev Shear.
That's true.
Thanks to Kev Shear. Blame Kev Shear for that, ladies and gentlemen.
Cody Lamas was right behind when Kev Shear wrecked there with Shelton in turn one, and he was able to avoid it to get sixth place. So great run for him. Johnny Gardner there in seventh. Jack Halleck, he must have felt like a man on a raft all by himself because nobody wanted to work with a two-time winner. He'll bring it home in eighth, though. William Flickinger, the Wookiee, as you called him. At least that's what it sounded like to me. He's going to finish ninth. And
you say I called him you said I called him a Wookiee. Well, you called him Flickinger, so. Fickle.
Oh, wow.
He's fickle.
No, actually, I realized that back when I said that, I called him Zach Flickinger, so I got the wrong Flickinger in the car.
Good job. We're just all failing.
We are. Hey, talk about a couple of drivers making the best of what was looking like a dire situation. Chris Dollerton, we saw he was off the pace after he got spun by Phil Parker that brought out the first caution. He battled back for a 14th place finish. Jordan Lopez, I know he got damage from the second wreck. He got 15th. How about the pole sitter, Kyle Matthews? He had damage from both of the wrecks that we had tonight, and he still got a 16th place finish.
Can't forget Seth Cole. He got damage from the first stack up under caution. Here he is finishing in the 13th position.
Well, I always forget about Seth Cole because he's not him when he's hungry.
And now here's the rest of the field that all retired from the wrecks. And, man, I'm pretty sure Jessica Shelton can't be too happy with Kev Shearer.
Well, the good news for her is she has those two wins in the bank. She had that win from last week, which locked her into the playoffs. So maybe that'll alleviate the sting just a bit. But you look at our retirees, only four of them down there at the bottom were out in the first wreck. Everybody else was after the big one, our second wreck over in turn one.
Yep. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this has been a production of the NNSCRA Offline Racing at its best. From Michael Norman and Seth Cole. Seth, thank you so much for joining me, and man, hopefully to see you back here again soon.
Thanks for having me. Really appreciate it. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah. So, for the Budweiser All-Pro Series here at Daytona, for Seth Cole and myself, we say, until we meet again.